I am Abdul Kader from Karnataka Polytechnic, Mangalore, once again welcoming you our next interactive class on professional ethics and Indian Constitution. We are currently discussing Unit 2. This Unit 2 is on engineering ethics. We have already taken two classes. This is the third and concluding class of Unit 2. In the previous two classes of this unit, we discussed engineering ethics and the nature of inquiries to solve the engineering problems with respect to ethics. We have seen the complexities involved in moral dilemma with case studies. We also studied moral development theories. The first theory was put forth by Lawrence Kohlberg, and the second theory which we discussed was put forth by Carol Gilligan. We also discussed the salient features of a profession. We have seen the meaning of professionalism. In this class, we'll be discussing different ethical theories. These theories provide a basis for deciding what is good and what is the bad. So this is the class 3 of unit 2. This class will be focusing on the ethical theories. Let's have a quick preview of the content we are going to cover in today's class. As I already said, we'll be discussing the ethical theories in this class. First, we'll be discussing the utilitarian theory. So this theory looks at the things from the utilitarian point of view, that is from the benefit point of view. So what gives maximum benefit to maximum people is good as per this theory. We'll be discussing this theory first. Then this utilitarian theory has got some serious flaws, some serious drawbacks. Then the next theory came into existence, what is known as the rule utilitarian theory, which is a modification of the utilitarian theory to overcome some of its flaws. The third theory which we'll be discussing is what is known as the duty ethics theory, which focuses on the different duties which the individuals have to perform. All of us have got rights. We have got liberty rights, we have got welfare rights, the seller has got rights, the consumer has got rights. Now this theory tries to look at the right or wrong with respect to the individual's rights. There is another theory, what is known as the virtues theory. This virtues theory tries to look at the things from a different point of view, not duties and rights, but by virtues, that is the character of a person is given importance in the virtues theory. Then there is another theory, what is known as a self-realization ethics theory. This discusses the ethics from a self-realization point of view. We'll be discussing ethical egoism in this theory. Then the justice is fundamental to the well-being of any society. So right or wrong is to be decided based on the justice. That's what the justice theory tells. We'll be discussing the justice theory. And then we'll be discussing certain important terms which start with the self. One is the self-control, which we need. Self-interest, whether it is good or bad, we'll be discussing it. Self-respect is an essential part of the personality of the individual. We'll be discussing the things related to self-respect. And we'll also be seeing what is self-esteem, and we'll see how does the self-respect and self-esteem are related and how does they differ from each other. And towards the end, after this class, we'll have an interactive quiz where you can actively participate. We'll have a nice time during the quiz. We'll have the interactions. First of all, let us see what is the use of these ethical theories. That is, why do we need ethical theories? Or how do these theories try to promote a healthy approach towards work and life? These ethical theories are useful in many respects. We'll discuss some of them. We face the moral dilemmas in our life many times. The moral dilemmas are the situations where decision taking becomes very difficult. There are good reasons for acting in a particular way, and there are equally strong reasons for not acting in a particular in that particular way. That is, the decision taking becomes extremely difficult when a person is faced with moral dilemmas. We have seen certain examples of moral dilemmas in our previous classes. In such situations, the ethical theories provide a clarity of thought, what can be done. And we need some consistency with respect to decision making when you are faced with difficulties. This consistency is provided by the ethical theories. So these ethical theories give a systematic and comprehensive understanding of the various aspects of the moral dilemma when you face it. That is the one very useful aspect of applying the ethical theories. These ethical theories are not just theoretical, they provide the practical guidance in moral issues. That is, when we are faced with moral issues, how do we solve these issues are to be based on certain well-defined rules and laws. These laws, rules gives the guidance to us about the moral issues. That is another use of the ethical theories. Then, the whatever decision we take, we need to justify the decisions on the professional ground. That is, our moral obligations are to be justified in front of the authorities, in front of the public. So this justification should have certain well-defined criteria, certain well-accepted the rules, well-accepted principles. The ways for justifying the decisions on ethical grounds is provided by the ethical theories. Now, coming to ethical theories, there can be sound theories, there can be unsound theories. So how do we evaluate theory? What are the criteria on which we decide the quality and applicability of a theory? Following, we'll discuss certain the criteria for evaluating an ethical theory. First of all, any theory need to be clear. So there should not be any ambiguity, there should not be any confusion regarding the theory. It should give a comprehensive, a coherent picture of the issues involved ethically. All these issues are to be logically connected in the ethical theory. That is, the ethical theory has to be clear, coherent, and logically intact. Another requirement of an ethical theory is that it has to be internally consistent. What I mean by consistent is the one part of the theory should not contradict another part of the theory. There should not be internal conflicts with respect to the different aspects of the theory. That is another criteria for judging an ethical theory. Then, any theory should depend on certain data, certain parameters for its defense. But this defense of an ethical theory must be based on facts alone. That means we should be able to justify a theory based on observable data. It is not the inference or opinion of a person may not make the basis for justifying an ethical theory. So all the justification what we provide for the ethical theory must be based on objective data. That is another requirement of an ethical theory. Then these ethical theories should address the basic the moral issues in a systematic and in a holistic, that is in a comprehensive the manner, that is the basic, the values involved are to be addressed in a holistic manner by the ethical theory, not a piecemeal approach. All said and done, if a theory is only a theoretical, if a theory gives only a vague theoretical idea of the concepts, it is not of any practical use. That means a good ethical theory should give proper guidance for decision and action in concrete situations. That is, we should be able to apply the theories in concrete decisions, concrete situations, and take concrete decisions based on the theories. That means we should be able to base our judgment in specific situations based on the ethical theories. These are the basic, the requirement of an ethical theory. Let me illustrate it with some simple examples. So let us consider an example. Science is a double-edged weapon. Science makes life healthy, useful, and comfortable. At the same time, science has its destructive uses. Let's look at an example. Now, the science allows you to make the explosives. These explosives have got the good use as well as the bad uses. Many times these explosives are used for the destructive purpose. Then how do we justify the manufacture of the explosives? Or do you mean to say that the informed consent of the public used to be obtained before making explosives or not? Similarly, coming to the same issue, whether the engineers have got a right to make the explosives and such the destructive devices without the informed consent of the public. If a theory does not address the informed consent of the public for a destructive activity, then we may conclude that the theory is somewhat inadequate. It does not address the issue properly. Coming to another example, see, all of us know that smoking is injurious. The cigarettes are harmful. Now, how do we justify the licensing of the cigarette industries when we say that the cigarette is harmful to the health? How do we say that we say it is harmful to the health, don't smoke, at the same time we license cigarette industries to manufacture this item? That is, you say suicide is bad, but in a way the cigarette reduces the lifespan of a person, that is accepted medically. In that case, do I allow the slow suicide, whether it is acceptable or not? Here again, what many people tell is that it's informed the choice. That means you inform the person all the bad effects of cigarette, and then that is his life and he can use it. At the same time, you can apply that to suicide also. You can say that is my informed choice. So the issues are very complex. Our moral theories should address these issues comprehensively. If it does not allow us to take the decisions in such situations, we may feel that the theory is inadequate. Coming to the theories, we'll be discussing the utilitarian theory first. Then we'll be discussing a modification of utilitarian theory, what is known as the rule utilitarian. Then we'll be discussing the third theory, what is known as the duty ethics theory. Then we'll be discussing the rights theory. We'll continue with the virtues theory. Then we'll discuss the self-realization ethics theory. And finally, we'll be discussing the justice theory. That is because the ethics is a complex subject which has got multiple dimensions. Each theory may not address all the dimensions, So one theory may try to explore the moral issues in particular the dimensions. All these theories together may be sufficient to give a comprehensive view of the moral issues involved in the concrete situations. Let us come to the utilitarian theory. So this was put forth by Jeremy Bentham and Stuart Mill. And basically, the purpose of this theory was to enable the legislators to make laws in parliaments, in assemblies. In making laws, what are the parameters they have to consider as a guidance for that? This theory was put forth. What does this theory say is that the right conduct is one. That means the right behavior is one which maximizes the good consequences. If the good consequences, good results are maximized, then that action is right. That's what the utilitarian theory says. That is, based on its use, we have to decide whether the theory is good or not. What we mean by good consequences is what is utilities here. That means the good result or good consequences is utilities. The balance and everything will have both good as well as bad consequences. If the good and bad are weighed and good consequences far exceeds the bad consequences, then it says that that decision is right. That means you weigh good and bad and decide what is to be done based on the balance. If the bad is more compared to good, that is should not be done. If good is overweighs the bad, that action is to be done. That's what the utilitarian theory says. So basically, this theory weighs the cost and benefits. That means what are the costs and what are the benefits. And if something that produces greatest satisfaction, that is greatest the benefit to the affected persons, that is the right thing as per the rules, as per the utilitarian theory. The next question is, how do we go about to apply the utilitarian theory? The procedure adopted is very simple. That means we have to evaluate the course of actions. Different actions that are open to us is to be evaluated. It has to be recorded. And then evaluate each action based on the benefit or harm. If you do it, what are the benefits? If you do it, what are the harm? That is, the benefit and the harm derived from each of the alternatives is evaluated. Next, greatest benefit and the least harm, that is aimed at. So any choice that gives the greatest benefit and least harm is ethically right. That is what the utilitarian theory says. So in effect, it tries to achieve the greatest good to the greatest number of people. Now, so this becomes the important, because when you build the public facilities like roads, like parks, many people will benefit, but at the same time, some people encounter losses also. For example, somebody's the house may have to be taken for road, for park, some other properties may have to be encroached for constructing the public, the facilities. Now, some people lose, many people gain. In that case, on the basis of utilitarian theory, we can justify that the loss is to few people, the gain is to a large number of people. Similarly, when you construct a dam, we have to look at the benefit and cost. The villages get drowned inside the water for the reservoir of the dam. That means many people are put into difficulties, but other people are benefiting out of that. This benefit and cost analysis is to be done. If the benefit far outweighs the cost. That is ethically right as per the utilitarian theory. Similarly, when you build nuclear power plants, there are very much the chances of nuclear radiation affecting people, employees. At the same time, the power generation benefits the many people. So these things are evaluated. Well, friends, I'm sorry for the interruption. We'll continue from where we left. Okay. We are discussing that there are certain serious flaws with respect to theory permits certain morally incorrect things. For example, if hanging an innocent person is beneficial to larger population, utilitarian theory permits it. But how can we hang an innocent person for the benefit of others? So this is a big problem in the utilitarian theory. That is, this theory permits certain wrong actions, a few immoral actions, so based on the utilitarian aspect. So this is not morally acceptable as per the ethics. That is, even if something is benefiting the large number of people, still there are certain moral guidelines to be followed for taking decisions. Let me take a very simple example. So there is an old computer in the office, and the owner does not use this old computer. An employer, what does he do is, he steals the computer and takes home, and he makes good use of the computer. He does all his work, useful work, using the computer. Now, if you look at the cost benefit, it has benefited the employee. He has taken it and then made it good use. If you come into the loss to the employer has not undergone any big the loss because of that. So that is, if you look at the utilitarian aspect of it, this is to be justified. The employee can steal the computer and go and make it more use, because the benefit he derives from that is much more than the loss which is incurred by the employer. But the morally, this is not the right, because the stealing cannot be justified even if it benefits even if the benefit is more compared to the loss. To overcome this advantage to this the disadvantage, what we have seen in an earlier example, the employer, he has to be a faithful agent of the employer. He is a trustee. The employee here has got placed a trust in the employee. So that means, how can we betray the trust based on the utilitarian aspect? To overcome this drawback, that is, the maximizing the benefit and minimizing the harm, is an essential part of ethics, but at the same time, there must be certain other guidelines for taking decisions. The maximum benefit should not violate these basic guidelines, and these guidelines can be called rules. So the utility alone cannot be the guiding principle for deciding right or wrong. There are certain moral rules which cannot be violated. So this was put forth by Richard Brandt. He said there are certain basic rules, like don't steal, don't harm others, don't bribe. So these are of primary importance, and these cannot be sacrificed for more benefit or more utility. So he suggested that the individual actions, whenever they are required, should be set by certain rules while maximizing the public good. That is, public good is all right, maximize world is good, but there are certain basic rules. Using these rules, the following rules, we have to maximize the public good. That's what the rule utilitarian theory says. Let's go on to discuss the next rule, next to the theory, what is known as the duty ethics theory. And this theory was put forth by Immanuel Kant. We have seen that we have got duties towards others. We have duties towards profession. We even have duties towards ourselves. Nobody can say, this is my life and I have a right to do whatever I want without harming others. In that case, I can even justify suicide. This suicide is not acceptable because we have duties towards ourselves also. We have got duties towards protecting our lives, protecting our health. This duty also cannot be violated as per the duty ethics theory. So duty ethics theory stresses the one's duties. That means the focus is on the duties. These duties include being honest in all our transactions, not causing any suffering to others because of our actions, being fair to others, following justice, being grateful to others for receiving their help, keeping our promises, and things like that. are the fundamental duties everybody has got, both as an individual as well as the professional. And these, the duty ethics theory stresses on the universal principle of the respect for authority. That is, we respect the rationality of the persons. This is more applicable to the professionals because professionals have got the responsibility towards the profession. So towards achieving this respect, we need to provide the autonomy to the professionals to take the best possible professional the decisions. So that is the autonomy is important in the duty ethics theory. Then, as I already said, we have got, in addition to others, we have also duties to the ourselves. We need to be rational, we need to be autonomous, and we have to take decisions based on our conscience, our moral, the judgment. That means the duty is not towards others alone. We have got inherent duties towards the ourselves. That's what I said. The duty to ourselves, in the extreme case, it says you don't have a right to suicide. At the same time, to a lower level, it applies to all other actions. We don't have a right to do wrong things because we have got a duty to ourselves to maintain our self-respect, our self-esteem, our moral consciousness. All these are the duties which a professional has to himself. In addition, professional also has a duty to use the talents in performing the duties. And as an example, the honesty is always the required duty. We say the honesty pays, at least in the long run. Now, the honesty, as far as a person is concerned, is not just for avoiding jail. It does not mean that you steal in such a way that nobody can catch you. That is not the ethical concept. The ethical concept, honesty, is not to avoid the jail or punishment. The purpose of honesty is to maintain one's moral integrity. That is, the honesty, being honest to oneself, is a part of the ethical, the responsibility of a person, what is called the duties. There are certain, now let us discuss the concept of the prima facie duties. Prima facie means something which is very obvious, which can be very clearly seen. Most of the duties are prima facie duties, but there may be some exceptions. This was the concept which was put forth by C.W.D. Ross. He said there are prima facie duties. That means most of the duties are the very obvious. That is, the prima facie duties are self-evident, and the fixing priority is also easy with respect to the prima facie duties. What he noted was, don't kill others is a prima facie duty. Protect innocent life is again a prima facie duty of every human being. Do not lie is also a prima facie duty. But there are the orders, there are the priorities. This has got a higher priority, this has got a higher priority. Compared to that, it has got the lower priority. So even in prima facie duties, all duties are not equally important. Some duties are sacrosanct. They are much more the strong compared to the other duties. At the same time, there are the people who criticize the prima facie duties. For example, the prima facie concept itself is not very clear. When we say the prima facie, what one person feels as prima facie may not be what another person accepts as the prima facie. So the very concept of the prima facie itself can be disputed based on the perception of the different the human, different human beings. So that is means there may not be sufficient guidelines to decide the prima facie-ness of duty. Coming to certain, the list of duties, we can classify the prima facie duties. One duty is towards the fidelity, that is towards trust and loyalty. We have got an obligation to keep promises. That is one part of the prima facie duty. Another part of prima facie duty is reparation. If we commit the errors, if we commit mistakes, we have got a right, we have got an obligation to compensate to others. That means the mistakes are to be corrected. Any losses are to be compensated. That's what we call the reparation. That's a prima facie duty. The gratitude is a prima facie duty. That means we have got a duty to thank those who help us. We have to acknowledge, we have to appreciate the help received by through gratitude. Justice is also a prima facie duty. That means we have got an obligation to fair to others in all our dealings. Beneficence, that means we need to recognize inequality and improve the conditions of others. Benevolence is also a prima facie duty. We have got the duty towards the self-improvement. That means every professional has a duty to enhance his professional knowledge and capacities. And non-maleficence, that is, we have got a duty not to injure the others. These are all some of the prima facie duties which is listed under the prima facie duties. So far we have discussed the utilitarian theory. Then we discussed a modified version of utilitarian theory known as rules utilitarian theory. Then we want to discuss duty ethics theory. And we discussed what are known as prima facie duties. Let us now move on to discuss the rights theory. All of us have got rights. After all, what do we mean by rights? The right is something which entitles us to act in a particular way, and also it entitles us to have somebody else act in a particular way. That means this right gives us a right to do some action, and also we have got a right to restrict other from doing whatever he wants because of this right. That means we can enforce our rights in our dealings with others. This rights is a protective barrier. It protects the individuals from any unjustified infringement. That means we need to know what is our right, and nobody has got a right to infringe upon our rights. We can claim these rights. We can demand this right. So that is the importance of rights. But we also need to remember that for whatever rights, there is also a corresponding the duty. So this is without duties, rights will not be there. So a right also implies a corresponding the duty on our part as well as the part of others. There are certain rights the advocated in the rights theory. One of the right is the right to access the truth. We have a right to be told the truth. Nobody can lie to us. Knowing the truth is the right of every individual. That is the one right. The right of privacy. The privacy is a very important issue. In its recent order, Supreme Court has recognized privacy as a fundamental right. There are a number of litigations in Supreme Court now against Aadhaar card, as it is claimed that it violates the privacy. Right now, if you read the newspapers, the final hearing is going on in Supreme Court with respect to the privacy rights. So the privacy of a person is also a very important right. Nobody can violate the privacy rights of others. Then the right not to be injured, that means we have got a right not to be harmed, not to be injured. This again is a right of a human being. Nobody can physically attack us. Nobody can even mentally harass us, because we have got a right not to be injured either physically or psychologically. Of course, there are certain examples like sometimes the people voluntarily risk like the Formula One racing or the mountain climber. Knows that there's every chance of the injury of death when you climb the Himalayas or the Mount Everest. The things like that are voluntary risk a person takes. Otherwise, every person has got a right to reject the possibility of the injuries. And then the right to what is the agreed. That is, we have got a right to demand what is promised by us from others. When we agree into a contract or some sort of agreement, we have got a right to demand that other person fulfill, other person stand by those agreement. These are the certain rights advocated in the rights, the theory. The coming to the rights will fall under two categories. The human right will fall under the liberty rights as well as the welfare rights. Let us discuss what is this, the liberty right, and what is its welfare right. We need to remember that all of us are born as human beings, and because we are born as human beings, we are entitled to certain rights. These are the basic rights available to everybody just because of being born as human beings. No other qualification is necessary for human rights. Human rights are not privileges granted by any government, nor concessions which can be withdrawn. These are the inalienable rights available to everybody. That is, the liberty right is a right which everybody can exercise with respect to liberty or freedom. Nobody can interfere with the freedom of another person. Coming to the certain features of the liberty rights, first of all, the liberty rights are natural. They are not created by any government or authority. They are naturally available to every human being, the liberty right. Everybody is born free, and everybody has got a right to live free by nature. And these are universal. Everywhere in the world, the human beings have got human rights. They are not dependent on any country. They are not dependent on a society, any culture. Entire world, the human beings have got the liberty rights. And they are all equal. There cannot be any discrimination with respect to the liberty rights on the basis of the caste, on the basis of race, on the basis of creed, on the basis of gender. None of the parameters like caste, race, gender, nationality can be a bar for discrimination, can be a basis for discrimination. People have got equal access to the liberty rights, irrespective of all such factors. And these rights are inalienable. That is, it cannot be separated from the person. For example, somebody cannot say, I surrender my freedom right. That it is something like selling. You give me 1 crore rupees, I will sell myself to you. That means I can be your slave. That is what the surrendering one person's the liberty right, the freedom means. That means that is not possible. It cannot be surrendered under any situation, nor it can be taken away under any situation. You cannot buy a person's privacy, a person's the freedom. You cannot threaten and get a person's freedom. You cannot bargain. So under no situation, the freedom of a person cannot be separated from the individual. Coming to the welfare rights, the welfare is a right of a needy person to a decent human life. That means everybody has got a right to live a decent human life. the benefits of the society should be available to every human beings. Let's look an example. Say one or more person die of starvation without food. Can we say that they didn't work and they didn't get money, so they died? They should have earned their money and survived. No, that cannot be an explanation. Starvation deaths are serious human rights violation. Not just food, supporting weaker sections of society is also the duty of the government. In addition, the directive principles of our constitution wants to make India a welfare state. This welfare state is supposed to take the welfare of all the people of the country into consideration. That's why the government comes up with a number of the welfare schemes for the poor and the needy persons. So this welfare right is also part of the human rights. Coming to the economic rights, the people have got the economic rights also. The manufacturer has got his economic rights. The seller has got his economic rights. The service providers have got economic rights. Even the consumer has got the economic rights. These are also part of the rights a person enjoys. The consumer is also a very important entity in a business cycle. If the businessman is one side, consumer is on the other side. If the businessman has its rights, the consumer also has got a number of rights. Coming to the rights of the consumers, the consumer has got a right to information. That means he has got a right to be told about the product and process in advance. So if a person is selling a product or giving a rendering a service, to know about the details of that is the right of the consumer. Similarly, the safety, no manufacturer, no service provider can ignore the safety of the consumer because he has got right to safety. And consumer has got a choice. Nobody can force a consumer to buy something against his will. So the consumer has got a right of choice. The consumer has got a right to be heard about the grievances. So consumer has got a right that his grievance should be addressed. Whatever the company offers, guarantees and warranties, the consumer has got a right to address his grievances. Many times the grievances are with respect to the statements. Even some of the things are not specifically mentioned in the contract. There are certain implied aspects that also the consumer can demand. And the consumer education is also the right of the consumer. The educated about a product, about a process, about a service is also right of the consumer. Let us come to the next theory. That is what is known as virtuous theory. So we have discussed utilitarian theory, rules utilitarian, duty ethics, and rights theory. Now, this is another theory. This theory is based on emphasizing the character rather than the rights and duties. So here, the focus is on virtues, that is, focus on the morally desirable characters of the individuals. This always tries to achieve a balance between two extremities. This always tries to achieve a golden mean, neither this extreme nor that extreme. You might have heard Mankutimanaka Govadi Deve. What does he say? Is it Smita Virali Vadanadali Kivige Kelisadirali, Hita Virali Vachanadali Ritava Bedadirali, Mita Virali Manasin Udvegadali Bhogadali, Ati Beda Veliyu Mankutima. The focus is that you avoid the excess in all the aspect. That's what the virtues theory says. There should not be deficiency, there should not be excess. Let us discuss it in a little more detail. Coming to the truthfulness. Truthfulness is a virtue. But at the same time, revealing each and every information to everybody will violate confidentiality. We cannot do that. We cannot have the excess of truthfulness, go and announce it to each and every person you meet. At the same time, you cannot be secret, secretive. Don't reveal everything, keep everything secret. These are the two extremes. What we need is a golden balance. That is, you give sufficient information to the required person. To whom he has to give, you have to give information, exactly that information has to be given to the required person. That is a balance. Similarly, courage. Courage is a virtue. That is, the act facing danger and facing risk is a virtue, but that does not mean that you be rough, you be rash. That is not the courage. At the same time, coward, no courage. That is also not the right thing. You have to be firm. At the same time, you have to be humble. That means the courage means we have to be the firm, at the same time humble. Neither this extreme nor this extreme. Generosity, that is giving to others, is again the virtue. But at the same time, we cannot waste resources in the process of giving. That has to be avoided. And some people are very miserly. They never share resources. That's also not right. What is that you give in the appropriate the measure. So that is, we need a golden balance between excess and deficiency with respect to generosity. Coming to friendliness. Always, whatever other person tells, be smiling, accept it without giving your vote again is not a right thing. Don't listen to others, always bad-tempered. Whenever somebody tells, they criticize it and shout it. That again is not a right thing. That means we need communication with decent limits. We have to contact others, we have to criticize others, but constructively, decently, within limits. That is, neither this is acceptable nor this is acceptable. This is the right way. Similarly, environment. We need to use the environment. We cannot neglect environment in our aspect. We cannot try to exploit the environment. We need to protect the environment. That means the all our activities should be based on the protection of the environment. The effect on environment is to be carefully analyzed, and based on that we have to take our decisions. Coming to the work and earn, we cannot go for very tiresome work. That is, extremely strained work will not last in the long run. We cannot be lazy also. We need a work life or work leisure balance. We need to put in hard work. At the same time, we need the rest to refresh ourselves, to make us available for hard work in future. So that is, even the work, the leisure balance is to be approached from the golden mean concept. Coming to self-realization ethics theory, the right action here, what he means is that self-fulfillment is the right action. When I say self-fulfillment, the one version takes about the caring relationships. You achieve your fulfillment by a carefully, the caring relationship with respect to other individuals and society. That's one aspect of self-realization ethics. In another version, they talk of ethical egoism. That means you have got an ego, but that is an ethical ego. You don't listen to others, but at the same time, you very carefully, strictly follow your the moral principles. Your decisions are based on what is good for yourself. Here you are not caring for the society or opinion of the others, because you are very want to insist, stick on what is the right as per your ethical viewpoint. Next is the justice theory. The justice theory is based on the fairness. So we have to treat the people based on justice. That means the treatment need not be the same. Depending on the other person's situation, we need to treat the other person. The justice is the important consideration. The number one question in the justice theory is, how fair is an action? That means, can we justify this action based on justice? The favoritism, that means showing partiality, positive partiality to our people is also wrong. Similarly, discrimination showing negative partiality to our people is wrong. We have to be fair by avoiding both the favoritism as well as the discrimination. So this fairness avoids the controversies. This fairness or justice is very much essential for a peaceful atmosphere in any organization. I'll illustrate a simple example. So this is what we call equality. You have given the equal length of stool to everybody. But that is not justice, because he can easily get his apple, but he cannot get. But where is justice? You have given equal the stools. You said equality. Everybody has given equality, but that is not justice. But this is justice. He needs only one stool. You have given only one. You have given him two. He gets it. Even with two, he cannot reach the apple. You have given him three. He reaches it. So this is what the justice, we call it as the equity. This is the equality. Equality need not be justice, but equity is the justice. This is how we need to treat people, based on equity. Sometimes equality may lead to injustice, but equity is the important thing. Now, we are coming towards the end of our class. We'll discuss certain important the terms. One of the term is the self-control. So self-control means the maintaining personal discipline. That is a self-discipline. We maintain discipline based on our own free will. That is the self-control. The motivation for self-control is we can avoid, by self-discipline, we can avoid fear. We can avoid hatred. We can avoid the lack of efforts on our part. We can avoid the temptations by self-discipline. Self-deception can be avoided. We can give proper emotional response. We can avoid wrong emotional response when we have got the self-control. Self-control covers the courage and good judgment in all our action. Obviously, self-control promotes self-respect. There are certain important the ingredients to self-control. One is balance. The extremities are to be avoided in our response, in our talk, in our action, decisions. We need to have a proper balance, neither this extreme or that extreme. There will be a number of provocations. Even in the face of the provocations, we need to achieve certain amount of the calmness is required as a part of self-control. A self-controlled person has got a very strong determination. So he knows exactly what he has to do and is determined to achieve that. For that, the person needs a lot of the willpower. He should not waver in the face of difficulties. He should not shake when the problems come. So the willpower is required, and confidence in his abilities is also important for the self-control. We'll discuss the second term, what is the self-interest. Self-interest is being good and acceptable to oneself. That means you are taking your interest as primary. In utilitarian theory, it means you provide respect to others and measure this based on the utility to everybody. Even in duty ethics theory, self-interest is taken care of because we also have got the duties towards ourselves. In ethical theories, in all the theories, the pursuing one's own goodness is not the wrong. Even the virtue ethics theory, the self-respect is achieved by the self-interest. That means the promoting self-interest in an ethical way is never considered the wrong. At the same time, this self-interest should not degenerate to ethical egoism, which is sometimes not acceptable. Here people become highly individualistic. They don't care about others. Only I'll operate as far as moral the principles. That also we go to the other, that's going to the other extreme. That means promoting one's own interest at the cost of the others in at all situations may not be very the proper. There are certain limits to self-interest. The ethical egoist, they don't accept the well-being of the community. They look at things only from their the viewpoint. So self-interest is acceptable, but they should not degenerate into egoism or selfishness. That's what the limits of self-interest means. Coming to the self-respect, the self-respect is valuing oneself in morally acceptable the ways. The self-respect includes recognizing oneself as well as the respecting the others. That means we need to respect the others also as part of the maintaining our self-respect. We need to have an appraisal system within ourselves. We need to value ourselves. We need to go for periodic introspection and to see whether we are what we are doing is morally right. So this balanced feeling of self-respect is part of the ethical self-respect of an individual. The self-respect indirectly means a person has got the intense agony or guilt for doing wrong things. When we do something wrong, if you feel internally very bad, that is part of the self-respect. A self-respecting person values himself and he feels bad when he does something wrong, and he has got a courage to accept it and correct it. The last thing what we will be discussing today is the self-esteem. It is also a related term to self-respect. But the self-respect is a moral concept. This is a psychological concept. So internally, how does a person value himself is the self-esteem. That is an internal evaluation of one person has about himself psychologically. That is the self-esteem. Here, the focus is on valuing oneself in morally suitable ways. Here the focus is having the positive attitude towards oneself. Some people may have an excessive self-esteem. Some people may have an unwarranted or low self-esteem. Some people may have a normal self-esteem. This includes the recognition and appraisal. It provides a sense of honor, self-control, and courage. But this is basically an internal feeling, not related to the external, the behaviors. Well, friends, in today's class, we discussed the several ethical theories, including utilitarian theory, rule utilitarian theory, duty ethics theory, rights theory, virtues theory, self-realization ethics theory, justice theory. The use of all these theories help us to determine what is ethical and what is not ethical from various the moral perspectives. Towards the end of the class, we discussed the certain terms like self-control, self-interest, self-respect, and self-esteem. Now, we'll move on to play an interactive quiz based on today's class. Thank you.